You've all seen the pattern of light produced when the sun shines through a glass of water, but how would you need to change the shape of the glass so that the pattern of light became a recognizable image, like this? This piece of acrylic is wobbly in just the right way to produce the image of a lion. And look how the image warps and changes when I change the orientation of the acrylic. I've also got this tiny mirror that projects the word fire from its reflection. And the word gets jumbled up as it gets too close to the wall. This is what it's like to look through the acrylic at a checkerboard. There's a hint of the lion shape there and the words, but you really couldn't discern from looking at the surface what you might expect the image itself to be. Here's one that shows the face of Alan Turing. Here's a brain. These different images are achieved by manipulating the shape of a lens, and it's a massive mathematical challenge. You've definitely seen accidental versions of this sort of image, caused by undulations in transparent materials. The most obvious example is ripples in a pool. See how the bright lines move around as the waves on the surface of the pool change shape. And you can understand those bright spots in terms of how a lens works. So you have parallel rays of light coming from the sun shining on the surface of the pool, and this curved part of the wave focuses the light. And if the curvature is just right, those rays will focus exactly onto the bottom of the pool, and you'll have an incredibly bright line. If the surface is either too curved or not curved enough, the bright lines won't be as sharp. A bit like how you get a blurry image in a photo if it isn't focused correctly. Other places you might see this sort of thing? A glass of water, sun shining through that weird glass ornament at your nan's house, looking inside an empty mug. This video about Penrose Unilluminable Room, link in the description. Or check out the inside of your wedding ring on a sunny day. You'll often see a sharp edge like this, and that's where the light rays change direction. What I mean is, if you get a laser pointer and sweep it over the surface, you could watch as the reflected point of light moves and see that at some point it changes direction. There's an inflection point. All those inflection points together form the curve, and these types of curves are called caustics. In fact, you may have heard of these images referred to as caustics, even though they don't contain any of those inflection points. That's probably because some of the early work with these sorts of lenses was attempting to produce bright lines, like you see in this one of the brain. This one really is made of caustics. Actually, caustics are related to those curves you can make with pegs and strings. This one in particular is like looking at the inside of a mug. But anyway, the question is, how can you create a lens, either a glass lens or a mirror lens, that produces the image that you want? Suppose you're starting with a picture of Alan Turing, and you want to be able to project that picture of Alan Turing onto a wall by shining light through a weird wobbly lens. The more you think about it, the more you can see the challenge there. Like, here's a dark region on the picture of Alan Turing, so I want to divert light rays away from there. But then those light rays are going to scatter to other parts of the image, and maybe I don't want those parts of the image to be lighter. So we want to shape the lens so that we redistribute the light in exactly the way that we want to. And brilliantly, this relates to an area of mathematics called optimal transport. A good example of an optimal transport problem is, I want to create a sand sculpture, like this, for example. And what I start with is a level tray of sand. So to make my sculpture, I need to move sand around. But I want to do it optimally. I want to move the fewest grains of sand the shortest distance. As a side note, the optimal transport problem really came into its own in World War II, when generals were thinking about moving dirt and rubble around while using the least amount of energy to do it, and they hired mathematicians to figure that out. But anyway, once I have my sculpture, there are shallower parts of the sand and deeper parts of the sand. And you can see how that would be analogous to the creation of an image using wobbly lenses. I start off with a flat, even coverage of light from my point source, and I want to move that light around to create bright regions and dark regions, like the deep regions and shallow regions of the sand. And because I want my lens to be as simple as possible, I want the light to be moved around as little as possible, just like with the grains of sand. And so it's an optimization problem. It's an optimal transport problem. A research scientist called Matthew Brand did a lot of the work applying the optimal transport problem to these wobbly lenses. And he really helped me out with this video. He also helped me out with an upcoming video about handmade holograms. That should be out next month, so make sure you're subscribed if you want to catch that one. The mathematics of the optimum transport problem are beyond the scope of this video, but I wanted to show you one part that's really interesting: power diagrams. This power diagram represents this distribution of light. In a power diagram, each region has an equal amount of power. So brighter regions are smaller and darker regions are larger. But if we want this distribution of light instead, we need to update the power diagram. Look, as it changes shape, you can see the dark regions that represent Einstein's eyes get larger and the brighter regions get smaller. Optimal transport involves a lot more than that, but once you have your solution, once you know that you want light from here to go there, light from here to go there, and so on, you code that into the curvature of the lens. So suppose I've decided that the light that lands here needs to end up over here. Well, I curve the surface of the lens appropriately at that point where the ray of light is leaving the lens. You do that all over the surface and you have your lens. It's more complicated than that, but that's the simplified version. A computer scientist by the name of Mark Pawley has contributed a lot to the understanding of how these things work. He very kindly sent me the Lion lens from his company Rayform. He also sent me the mirror, which would normally be part of a ring with a custom message. Link in the description if you want to get one of those for yourself. They're not paying me to say that, by the way. I'm just really grateful for their help with this video. I really like this image of the Olympic rings. What's nice about it is it's in color. And what's nice about it being in color is that when you look at the lens, you can see where the light comes from. And in fact, with a simple image like this, you can kind of make sense of it. Like, to get the black background behind the rings, all the light that would normally pass through there needs to be sent to one of the rings. So the colors of the rings stretch out to the very edges of the transparency. When you look at the image as it appears back on the lens in this way, it's called a pullback. And this isn't the only place you'll find pullbacks. This thing is called the sensory homunculus, and it shows how sensitive to touch different parts of the body are by changing the size of those parts of the body. And it's also a pullback. One thing I really like about these lenses is the transition between two recognizable things that really don't go together. Like this kind of pattern you recognize from all those times you've seen light shining through wobbly glass or light reflecting off a pool or whatever. This kind of light movement is familiar. Then it unexpectedly transitions into a recognizable image, and that's a really fun moment. I want to talk about the economics of printers, because it's really interesting and really annoying. Printer ink is extortionately expensive because of the business model that the manufacturers use. They sell the printers at a loss to entice you into buying one, and then you're locked into buying their printer ink, which is sold at an inflated price. Eventually, you end up paying more. It's a really annoying business model, and it has a name, the razor and blades model. It's called that because it was made famous by the manufacturers of shaving products. The handle is sold at a loss, and the blade cartridges have a huge markup. Wouldn't it be nice if you could just pay the right price for things, splash out on something that's well built, and then pay pennies for the consumables that go with it, instead of this weird pseudo-subscription model? That's true as much for printers as it is for razors, which is why I'm happy to have Henson as a sponsor of this video. They don't make printers, but they do make safety razors. You pay an honest price once for this beautifully engineered safety razor, and then you can buy your own quality blades for pennies. The Henson AL13 is what you get when a family-run aerospace machine shop pivots to making its own product. It's CNC machined to aerospace standards, and because it's all metal, the blades are well supported, unlike with the multi-blade plastic cartridge razors. And it's just nice to own something that's well made and that you will make good use of. Never mind the fact that the total cost of ownership would easily beat cartridge razors after just a few months. I must admit, I've never actually used a safety razor before, so I was a little bit apprehensive. But as you can see, I tried it just now, and of course, there's nothing to be scared of. And actually, I'm really happy with the results. Go to hensonshaving.com/Steve Mould and use the promo code SteveMould at checkout to get 100 free blades with your purchase of a razor. Just make sure both products are in the basket when you apply the code. The link is also in the description, so get yourself a precision engineered safety razor today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.